Yo guys, welcome to RenderRam, my name is Vieco, and today we're gonna be covering 5 super obvious 3ds Max features that you either knew your whole life or you discovered them just now after 2000 years of using 3ds Max. So let's dive deeper into the known, unknown depths of 3ds Max. But before we jump into our lovely depths, Evermotion has a few news. So, ARC models volume 283 spring trees 25% off. Look at this. These are the trees, 25% off. That's like, I think, 90 euros. And yeah, it's magical. I like it. Check out Evermotion website. Our first feature is gonna be modifier-based space warps. So look at this. So when you're in Max, just go to your create panel here and then in here, navigate to the little waves. And from the drop down, you can choose modifier-based. Now, you got these very commonly known modifiers. Bend, taper, twist, skew, noise, stretch. Okay, but what do you do with these? Take a look at this. I'm gonna select stretch. So you apply it like this. So you literally create it like a box. And now you can, you know, like pimp its properties the way you would, you know, usually pimp your modifier. So, but now get this. And now if you go here to the top left where the link and unlink button is, you have bind to space warp. So I'm gonna select my teapot. I'm gonna get this, you see like binding icon. And now you can long press and link it to this. And now what happened, our teapot is generally drawn to this space warp and it's bending to whatever the shape the space warp is. Another cool thing is when you click on the space warp, you have decay. So when you increase the decay, let's say to something like this, what will happen is the closer you go, the more bendy your object will get. But the further away you go, it's gonna transform to its original shape. So this is kind of like, you know, like distance related. The closer you go, it's gonna, you know, bend it, but then the further away you go, it's gonna return to the normal shape. Now you would think to yourself, that's cool, but where can I use that? Now let's imagine you are a farmer and you are growing carrots. This is our lovely plot of land and this is my lovely carrot here. Look at this. You go here to modifier-based space warps and let's say I'm gonna activate noise. So you literally like draw a box here. Let's say my Z is gonna be like my intensity is gonna be like this. You can see how the actual gizmo is modifying. So look at this, when I lower down the scale, you see like this happens. And I don't know, let's set here to also 2. And now look at this. I'm gonna use my bind to space warp, click on my piece of land and I'm just gonna link it to that space warp. If you go to your space warp here and just again use the decay button, so let's say something like this, you can now easily pluck your carrot in. So look at this, let me just lower the carrot down and boom, look at this. You got a kind of, you know, like rumbled dirt and you got your carrot in. The cool thing is, of course, if you clone this, let's say here, you again click on your land, click on bind to space warp and just link it there, you're gonna get another carrot. And you've just planted your second carrot. Now, where else? Trees, bushes, flowers, wherever has, you know, like a rumbled soil, you can literally mimic that effect very quickly with this. Another cool effect of that is, for example, like a sea dock. So look at this. I have a beach, I have my dock here, and I have these space warp gizmos here where the pillars are. And get this, I'm just gonna press play. And you can literally simulate some nice looking water effects. So yeah, in general, you have a lot of possibilities with this. Look, when you kind of move it around, you know, because of the decay, it's just gonna go, you know, harder and then softer, etc. So yeah, it's a cool handy feature. Our next feature is the feature that I thought that everyone knows. I thought that was like one of the first, you know, things that people use. And then I found out that people don't know that that even exists. And that's area to render. Now look at this. Area to render, it's all like view is the default setting. And then you have all these up, selected, region, crop, blow up. So look at this. Region, when you click on it, you can literally like select any region of your scene, press render, and it's gonna act like any other region that you have in your rendering engine, whether it was V-Ray, Corona, F-Storm, whatever. But now you can, for example, click crop. When you click on crop, it's the same region marker here. And when you click render, it's only gonna render that section. So you won't have, you know, the rest of the image as a region. On the other hand, you have blow up. So look at this, blow up, and the blow up is bound to your aspect ratio, so you cannot change the aspect ratio. It, you know, it is what it is. Let's say select this area and my resolution is 1920x1080, and when I click render, this is going to render that chunk in 1920x1080. And that's a really dope feature if you wanted, you know, just render chunks chunks of something in you know, the resolution that you need. On the other hand, this also has selected. I don't like that selected feature very much because it doesn't work like a regular select. So look at this. If I have, if I select, let's say this dock leg, so it's, I think it's this one. And when I click render, it's gonna render it completely solo. It's not gonna, you know, preserve all the shadow effects from the environment. So yeah, I don't use that one, but yeah, if for some reason you want it, it's there. Now let's say that in our lovely sea, you have, you know, a couple of objects taking a swim. We have a teapot, we have a torus knot, we have a sphere, all that is cool. There is this one awesome option, which is called Show Dependencies. So look at this. If you go to View, you have Show Dependencies. Now, as you can see, my torus knot turned pink. And if I click on my sphere, it's also pink. My teapot's pink. My dock is pink. So what does Show Dependencies do? Whenever you have objects that are like instances or references or anything similar, it will highlight in pink whatever is connected. So look at this. The pillars of my dock are all instances, and I'm just gonna select one and all of them are gonna be marked. Now, get this part. If I now select my torus knot, you can see that I have a push modifier, I have UVW map, and because of the italic text on the UVW map, you can notice that that's an instance. And now look at this. When I click on that, is gonna automatically show where is that instance shared. So it's shared this with the sphere because sphere has UVW map on it. And this is very useful because you can always, you know, like when you select an object, let's say show dependencies is off and I wanted to, you know, select my pillar, you can always go to edit and then select instances and it's gonna select them. But what if you constantly need to have a visual, you know, kind of representation where things are? In that case, show dependencies does a very great job. So you just go view, show dependencies, and let's say you need to move, I don't know, this dock here, and then, you know, this one here, this one here, this one here. You constantly know what you're dealing with, and again, it works with modifiers also, so yeah, this is a very cool feature. Now, our next feature. If you're animating, you might want to know this. So there is a feature that's called Show Ghosting. So this is an animation of a chair that I did. Look, it's all happy and bouncing. That's cool. But take a look at this. If I go to view, literally above the show dependencies, you have show ghosting. So when you click on show ghosting, this will actually give you a representation of the history on, like, in the past, I think 4 or 5 frames, what is happening with your object. And now look at this. If I just select my leg here, I'm gonna get what happens with that leg. So look at it. You literally can see where things are going. You know, there are scenarios where you're animating stuff and you're afraid that something is piercing something somewhere. You always need to find where that exact frame is, etc. This will literally show you like a chunk of time of where things were happening. And this is a very, very useful feature for any animation needs. And now the last feature. And this is the feature that I love a lot. So get this. When you go to customize, preferences, and you go to files, and here you have your out-of-back section, you can turn on prepend scene name. This is by default off. I have it on. So what does that do? So whenever you go to your auto backup folder, you're gonna always see a list of these auto backup files. So auto backup 1, auto backup 2, auto backup 3, etc. Now, if you have this button on, so look at this, my scene is called chair 12, and auto backup of that file is gonna be called chair 12 auto backup. So if you have like 3 maxes open, or if you are working with, you know, different projects, every auto backup file is gonna have a name of your current scene, and then it will have the underscore auto backup. Just one note about it. So like I said, this is very cool because you are gonna literally see in all the, like in the sea of auto backups, you're gonna see to which project does a certain auto backup, you know, point to. But there's one problem with it. It's not a problem, but it's worth mentioning. If you set, as I have here, number of backup files 10, so that means that it's gonna save 10 autobacks. When you have prepend scene name on, it's gonna save 10 autobacks per scene. So if I'm handling, let's say, 3 scenes, it's gonna save in total of 30 autoback files, 10 for each scene. So you kind of need to watch out so that your folder over time doesn't get clogged with many different projects and many different autobacks, because it's literally gonna, you know, set up 10 new autobacks for each project. But hey, you're gonna know which autoback is which. So yeah, I mean, turn it on if you like. If you're struggling with hard drive space, better turn it off. but I love this feature. And that's it for today, guys. I hope you enjoyed today's video. Evermotion, thank you for sponsoring this video. See you in the next one. Bye.